At headquarters, Air Technical Service Command, Colonel Ralph Nemo, Chief of Personnel and Base Services Division, delivers an important message to veterans of the Army Air Forces.
The Air Technical Service Command is charged with one of the biggest jobs in the Army Air Forces, the development, procurement, distribution, and maintenance of all Army Air Forces equipment. The Air Technical Service Command needs help to do this job. It needs your help. Towards that end, you veterans are being personally contacted by the Personnel Distribution Command Hospital Liaison Officers. Following the policy of General Arnold, the Air Technical Service Command is endeavoring to place each Army Air Forces veteran on the job for which he is best suited. With installations in nearly every state in the Union, the Air Technical Service Command will attempt to place those of you who qualify in any one of nearly 6,000 types of jobs. These are positions with good pay, near your home, or in whatever part of the country you desire to work. You men and women have demonstrated your ability as members of the mightiest Air Force the world has ever known. The Army Air Forces is depending on you to continue to play a part in this war and to speed the day of victory that will bring your buddies home.
In August 1909, the first Air Corps in the world was created by the United States Army with the purchase of one of the earliest Wright Brothers heavier-than-aircraft. The delivery of this crude machine marked an important step in the history of aviation. Since that day, Army engineers have paced the world in the experimentation, testing, and development of airplanes. The Air Technical Service Command, with its headquarters at Wright Field, Ohio, has played a major role in building the world's greatest Air Force. This mighty organization is responsible for design, procurement, distribution, and maintenance of all AAF equipment, from the smallest bolt to the biggest bomber. Besides all types of aircraft, this includes nearly 500,000 separate items of equipment. Here is one of the chief supply and representative air bases for the AAF. Huge warehouses surround the field and house the ever-increasing flow of material and supplies. Thousands of workers from all walks of life share this tremendous task of maintenance and supply. Freight carriers and combat fighters, destined for ports of embarkation to the battlefronts of the world, pass through its depots daily. The Air Technical Service Command procures and delivers all Air Force's materiel. They are also responsible for maintenance and repair of all Army aircraft. This already vast organization is expanding daily to meet increasing demands from its widespread tributaries. Through the years, the foremost aeronautical engineers in the country have been associated with the Air Technical Service Command. Under their direction and with the aid of skilled technicians and mechanics, airplanes are developed, improved, and simplified to speed production lines. The arrival and departure of so many test and experimental flights makes Wright Field one of the busiest airfields in the country. This big B-17E flying fortress is making a perfect landing. One of the outstanding features of Wright Field is this giant wind tunnel, one of the largest in the world. Here, wing sections, fuselages, and tail assemblies undergo high-speed tests, equivalent to 400 and 500 miles per hour in actual flight. Here is a test showing the airflow over an accurate model of a wing. Under the heavy stress and strain of high-speed maneuvering, the airflow and lift of the wings and tail section are studied. During certain maneuvers, the tufts indicate the turbulence on the wing surface. They should smooth out as the airplane levels off. Innumerable tests like these have helped to achieve the high-speed maneuverability that is so essential in aerial warfare today. One of the most vital and sensitive parts of the modern airplane is the propeller. Endless research is carried on to attain perfection under all kinds of flying conditions. To achieve endurance, perfect balance and symmetry are necessary. Propellers must be built to utmost strength and still be delicate enough to react to subtle tests like this. The variable pitch propeller has helped conquer the higher altitudes of 40,000 feet or over. Utmost efficiency can now be achieved at all speeds and highest levels. On specially designed torque stands, running tests are made to determine operating efficiency and horsepower on all types of aircraft engines. Actual flying conditions are simulated by changing propeller pitch, fuel mixtures, and engine speed. High on rigid concrete blocks, the propeller is put to the real test. Hour after hour, day after day, they undergo this endless grind. Run at maximum speeds, and under the most trying conditions, these tests are continued until the propeller shatters or until it meets the rigid requirements set up by the Air Corps. The propellers are subjected to simulated bad weather conditions, such as heavy rain, sleet, and ice accumulations. A big four-blader starts this long, hard grind to perfection. If an engine is disabled in aerial combat, it may be completely stopped by feathering the propeller. This turning of the leading edges directly into the wind completely streamlines the propeller. Feathering cuts down the danger of additional damage to the engine, conserves precious gasoline, eliminates windmilling and drag, and eases the burden of the remaining engines. Many a battered warrior has returned safely from the battle zone because of this modern engineering development. Ever since man has been building airplanes, Army engineers have been testing them. Sometimes the tests are costly and call for destruction of equipment, but the consequent findings result in the saving of untold lives and materiel. The latest tricycle landing gear is tested to ascertain the maximum pressure and strain it will stand. Note the buckling of the fuselage from the heavy drop. Additional weight is gradually added until the load is far greater than that created by normal landing conditions. In this way, the maximum landing safety factor is determined, and any weak points in the landing gear itself are discovered. Rolling down on the Wright Field runway speed, airplanes in landing gear undergo rigid landing and takeoff tests. Heavily engined and streamlined, today's airplane lands at heretofore undreamed of speeds. Tricycle landing gears add much to the maneuverability of airplanes on the ground, and offer easy steering through the flexible front wheel. On the takeoff, the airplane is in a flying position at all times, thus eliminating the raising of the tail just before leaving the ground. Hydraulic control has been one of the greatest fields of development. Landing wheels are thus controlled to ensure maximum efficiency. Wing landing flaps, which must resist strong pressure, are also best controlled hydraulically. The hydraulic system applies to brakes and many of the flying instruments. Bomb bay doors open their gaping mouths with the aid of hydraulic oil pressure. These oil lines run throughout the length and breadth of modern airplanes, forming intricate patterns. To ensure the strongest pipes and connection fittings, Air Corps engineers have devised testing apparatus like this. Oil line systems can withstand pressure of over 6,000 pounds per square inch. Here, the connection itself is stronger than the original pipe. In order to study and test the reactions of men, materiel, and fluid to the light pressure and thin air of newly conquered altitudes, a high altitude chamber was devised and installed at Wright Field. At the turning of a knob, persons inside the steel-banded airtight compartment can be projected into atmospheric conditions of 30, 40, or 50,000 feet altitudes and over. Their reactions can be studied through the windows in the compartment. Here is what happens when a human being is not supplied with sufficient oxygen under rarefied atmospheric conditions. To compare reflex action, the two men play cards. One of them will wear a mask and receive the additional oxygen necessary to maintain the proper balance. A twist of the dials and off they go on their simulated flight. The pressure inside the chamber changes with the corresponding rise in altitudes. Inside the chamber, the one oxygen supply is adjusted to the rear atmosphere. As the pressure and oxygen gradually decrease, the reflex action becomes slower, and more oxygen is needed as higher altitudes are attained. Without enough oxygen, this man gradually loses control of his reflexes. His head weaves from side to side as the blackness due to insufficient oxygen rises to his brain. Without life-giving oxygen, man is helpless in higher altitudes. Oxygen is gradually led into the chamber to revive the overcome subject.